In this video, we're going to go over the rules for setting up a Punnett square for a dihybrid cross. Even though a Punnett square for a dihybrid cross may look more intimidating than that for a monohybrid cross, still we'll be following the same basic rules that we used, and we can get the same types of information from the results. Now, one thing to keep in mind, here we're dealing with two different genes. So let's say that our starting parents are both heterozygous for the A and B genes. So both parents have a dominant and a recessive allele for the A gene and a dominant and a recessive allele for the B gene. The first thing we need to do is figure out which types of gametes this parent can produce. Keep in mind the gametes will always have one allele for each gene, meaning each gamete will have both an A allele and a B allele. Gregor Mendel's law of independent assortment told us that the allele we get for the A gene does not determine which allele we'll get for the B gene. And so we can get capital A and capital B as a potential gamete, but just as likely we can get capital A and lowercase b, or lowercase a, capital B, lowercase a, lowercase b. Even though capitals should go before lowercase letters when they're both the same letter, in this problem, the A's will always be listed first and the B's will be listed second. So we've set the potential gametes for the first parent along the top of the square. The second parent has the same genotype, and so they have the same potential gametes. Capital A, capital B, capital A, lowercase b, lowercase a, capital B, and lowercase a, lowercase b. Now it's time to start determining what potential offspring would result from the combination of these gametes. To do that, we list both A alleles first and both B alleles second. We need to look at what alleles are provided by the gametes on top of each column, and also look at what alleles are provided by the gametes in front of each row. So this first square is going to be capital A, capital A, capital B, capital B. Notice that this offspring has a total of four alleles, two A alleles and two B alleles, just like the parents. Each of these boxes that we fill in represents a potential possible offspring from this cross. In this next box, we have capital A, capital A, capital B, lowercase b. We have capital A, lowercase a, capital B, capital B, capital A, lowercase a, capital B, lowercase b. These are the genotypes of the potential offspring, each of these gametes from the first parent being combined with a capital A, capital B gamete from the second parent. Now, another thing I want you to take note of in this Punnett square is that it is symmetrical. So the same sequence of genotypes we have along that top row is going to be the sequence of genotypes we get going down the first column. Capital A, capital A, capital B, lowercase b, capital A, lowercase a, capital B, capital B, capital A, lowercase a, capital B, lowercase b. There are two more genotypes that I would like to fill in. And this is the second row, third column, and the third row, second column. Now, one thing I would like you to notice about all nine of these 16 boxes that we filled in so far, they all have at least one capital A and one capital B, meaning these offspring will look dominant for both traits because they have at least one capital letter from each gene. The next box to fill in is going to be second row, second column. Big A, little b. Here's a case where we have an offspring who would be dominant for the first gene, but recessive for the second gene. We'll see this in two more areas as well. Second row, last box, big a, little b. And then second column, last box, big a, little b. In both of these cases, dominant for the A gene, but recessive for the B gene. Now, when we look at the third row, third column, we get little a, capital B, capital B. In this case, we're dominant for the B gene, but recessive for the A gene. In fact, we'll see this a few more times, little a, capital B, lowercase b, little a, capital B, lowercase b. In both of these cases, we see recessive for A, but dominant for the B gene. And the very last square will be recessive for both, little a, little b, recessive for A, and recessive for B. This is the result that Gregor Mendel saw with his dihybrid cross, where 9/16 were dominant for both traits, 3 out of the 16 were dominant for gene A, but recessive for gene B, 3 out of 16 were recessive for gene A, but dominant for gene B, and only 1 out of 16 were recessive for both the A and the B genes. Now, another thing to emphasize with this Punnett square. This Punnett square is not telling us that these parents will have exactly 16 children, and it's not telling us the order in which these children will be born. Instead, what this square is telling us is that each time these parents have a child, the likelihood of determining what traits and characteristics that child will have will be based on this chart. There's an equal probability of falling into any one of these 16 boxes on the chart. But we see 9 out of those 16 boxes would result in an offspring who's dominant for both traits. 3 out of the 16 boxes would result in an offspring dominant for the first trait, but recessive for the second. 3 out of 16 would be recessive for the first trait, but dominant for the second. And only 1 out of 16 would be recessive for both. Now you may be wondering, why do I need to know this information? How is this relevant? Well, let's give a slight example. In Labradors, there is a gene that determines coat color. The capital B allele is for black fur. And the recessive B allele is for brown fur. There's also another gene, N, where the dominant normal copy of this gene results in normal vision. However, the mutated allele, little n, this is a recessive allele, which could cause blindness. And so, we have two dogs, which our parents were thinking of breeding them together to make puppies. Their genotype is that they are heterozygous for the B gene and heterozygous for the N gene. So what is their phenotype? What do they look like? Well, they have at least one copy of the dominant allele for the fur color. So they have black fur. And they have at least one copy of capital N. So they have normal vision. If both of these dogs are used as the parents, and again, looking at them, they would just look like normal black labs. You wouldn't be able to tell anything about them. What would we expect the phenotypes and phenotypic frequencies of the puppies to be? Well, this goes exactly back to that type of Punnett square which we had just made. And what that Punnett square would tell us is that most of the puppies, more than half of them, they would have black coats and normal vision. But we would get some puppies who had black coats and were blind, some puppies who had brown coats and normal vision, and the least likely result would be puppies with brown fur and who are blind. Now, if you're breeding Labradors, likely you do not want a quarter of the offspring to be blind, so you likely would not choose to use those two parents as a breeding pair. But before that cross was made, likely we didn't know that both of those parents were heterozygous for that N gene. So this is just one way this information we used can impact everyday life. Now that we have this information, we can see how traits are inherited from one generation to the next.